Welcome to Conversations on the Coast, San Francisco's premier author interview program. Today we have a book that I want to first get the title off my chest because it's so long and interesting. The title is Hotel on the Corner of Bitter and Sweet. It's a novel by Jamie Ford and published by Ballantine Books. And you're very kind to stop by.
Thanks for having me.
I know you're heading into the East Bay tonight. And so it's good that you could stop. The book is set in Seattle during World War II. There is an actual place in Seattle called the Panama Hotel. And that hotel plays a critical role in your story.
There is a real place. It's not on the corner of Bitter and Sweet. It's actually on the corner of 6th and Main, which isn't quite as sexy.
Bitter and Sweet's much better.
Yeah, yeah.
They might want to move it.
That's right. They might rename those streets. And the hotel's there. It was a hotel that was purchased in the mid-80s by a new owner. And at that time, she went down to the basement and found the belongings of 37 Japanese families that had been...
So that part of the book is absolutely true. It was used as a storage place for indentured, if you will, or...
people that were taken to the
jailed,
camps. Sure, incarcerated. Sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, it's a very real place, and the belongings had been there for 4+ decades.
There's another thing that comes up very early in the book. The main one of the main characters is going to school. His name is Henry Lee, and he's going to a school that's all English kids. And because that's what his father wants him to become, an American. And his father is afraid that he'll be brought in with the Japanese, so he makes him wear a button.
He does. He pins a button to his chest that says, I am Chinese. And it's another piece of nonfiction. It's a button my father wore when he was about 15 years old, just to separate him from his Japanese neighbors, at least in the eyes of the white people in the greater Seattle area.
Having said that, it makes one think about something you probably don't want to think about. That it's World War II, it's 41, 42, 43, something like that. And there's hatred in the streets of this country. Hatred for the Japanese, hatred for the Germans.
There was. I mean, and there was a real hysteria at the time. I mean, there were people accusing Japanese farmers of growing their crops in the direction of the Puget Sound Naval Shipyard, as if Japanese bombers would follow those directional strawberry fields and drop their payload. So there was a real hysteria at the time, and there was a real panic.
And so much marvelous fiction.
And wonderful, wonderful stuff that's fodder for fiction.
Oh, certainly. My gosh. The essence of Hotel on the Corner of Bitter and Sweet, though, or maybe it's got two essences. I mean, I want to say, forget all of that stuff. This book is a fantastically well-written and well-conceived love story. And it says something about love and the power of love because of the setting. In the midst of all the hate, in the midst of all the killing of the Great War, World War II, there exists this love story between Henry Lee, Chinese, with the sign, and Keiko Okabe.
Keiko Okabe.
So, and it starts in, what is it, the fourth grade of school?
About the sixth grade.
Sixth grade.
About the sixth grade. Mm-hmm. It's a very precocious, innocent kind of love story. Between a young Japanese boy and a Chinese girl at an all-white private school in the middle of a city that thinks they all look alike anyway.
Rainier Elementary. Yeah. It's amazing. Now, they begin this relationship, and the love story of the book is how they preserve that relationship through a lot of difficulty.
It is. It's really two sort of innocent, noble characters in a setting where their parents perhaps come from different worlds. They're not exactly golfing buddies at a time, but the next
far from it.
But the next generation is a generation of children that are all going to school together, and so they are friends, and there is an affection between them.
Let's talk about the parents. Let's talk about Henry's parents. Henry's father has been fighting the Japanese forever. He hates them.
He does. He's a nationalist in his heart. And there, you know, there definitely was an immigrant population that came over and had lived in the States for years and years and years, but in their heart, they were still going back someday. My grandfather was 80 and very Americanized, but he still talked about retiring to China at some point beyond his 80th birthday, you know?
And this father is talking about sending his son back to China to finish his education.
To finish his schooling.
And his main work, if you will, is raising money for the Chinese war effort against the Japanese.
Exactly. And there were war drives. There were nationalistic bonds raising funds to fight the war back in China, which started 10 years before Pearl Harbor.
Hotel on the corner of Bitter and Sweet has a lot of interesting characters, like a school cafeteria cook and a Seattle street musician. Stay tuned.
You're listening to Conversations on the Coast with Jim Foster. Follow us on Twitter at JimFosterCoc or send an email to JimFosterCoc@gmail.com.
Hotel on the Corner of Bitter and Sweet. That's the title of our novel today. The author, Jamie Ford, has been nice enough to stop by, and his book is published by Ballantine, and an author who has a lot to do in this country with things Asian, if you will,
sure.
in terms of writing about Asia. Lisa C. says, this impressive, bitter, and sweet debut novel explores the age-old conflicts between father and son, the beauty and sadness of what happened to Japanese Americans in the Seattle area during World War II and other areas as well, and the depths and longing of what she calls, and I like this phrase, what she calls deep heart love.
That's nice.
And that's a nice phrase because it says that there's something in this love that's going to make it possible for it to survive a lot of nasty stuff. Now, this conflict between father and son really rages, and Henry's defiance, I think, shows him as being quite courageous.
Yeah, I mean, between fathers and sons, there's always going to be a tearing or a separation, you know, as that child tries to form his own identity. When the father's identity is so rooted in Chinese culture and not rooted in American culture, but his son is going to, you know, an all-white private school where he's ostensibly being forced to become more American, there's going to be grit between them. There's going to be angst. And that plays a big part in the book, that relationship. And it spans to the main character of Henry, his own son, years into the future when he's in his 50s and he's still trying to bridge this gap that he sort of transferred to his own relationship with his own son.
Those are the kinds of things you can't leave behind because it's been made so much a part of you. When he's a kid in like the sixth grade, he has to be careful how he walks home because his father would not approve of what he starts doing, walking through the Japanese section of town in order to be with Kiko.
Right. I mean, he's comes from a family where he's not allowed on that side of town. That's the wrong side of, you know, that's enemy territory. But he starts going there because he's develops this affection and this fondness for Keiko, and they begin spending time together on the wrong side of you know, basically Nihonmachi in Japantown.
Another person of courage, and perhaps, at least I wrote this down, a real hero, is Mrs. Beatty. The cafeteria.
The lunch lady.
Yes, the lunch lady in the cafeteria at school.
Yeah, the strong-arm lunch lady, who's kind of a complex
who
character.
Who smokes a lot.
Yeah, she smokes and she mixes everything with her dirty hands in the you know, kind of every child's nightmare in the kitchen. But, you know, beneath that, you know, that crusty exterior, there's someone that has a beating heart. And actually, you know, she has a bit of an affection for you know, the oddballs in her school, who are Henry and Keiko.
Yeah. One of the other things she does, I think she does, because I think you leave it rather questionable. Keiko and her family are taken out to an internment camp, and Mrs. Beatty gets the job of taking kind of Japanese food out there. And Henry goes along to wash trays and serve food just as he did at school. And you suggest in the novel.
It's a little ambiguous, but there's a nod toward
that. That she's getting this Japanese food either for free at a very good price through her cafeteria connections.
Right. Yeah, we sort of find out that she has some altruistic motives with a profitable lining there. So she's doing the right thing.
She's a black marketer.
Sure, exactly.
That's what she is.
Maybe a gray marketer.
the other thing is she needs cigarettes.
Sure.
Yeah. So, I mean, and in those days, if you didn't have something else going
That's
on,
right.
you're not going to get cigarettes.
That's right. You know, Robin Hood was a black marketer too. You know, it's that, and that's sort of the nobility of her character is she's doing the right thing. She's not, breaking character to do this. She doesn't have a life changing moment. It's just kind of inside her. And she's kind of indicative of a lot of people at the time. There were many neighbors that looked after, their Japanese neighbors' homes and properties and stored their belongings. And, you know, she's kind of a representative of the people that went out of their way despite, objection from their peers and neighbors to do the right thing.
Now, there's another richly drawn character in this book, which may be because of your love for jazz, Sheldon the sax player.
Ah, the sax player, sure. I've always had a fascination with South Jackson, and that's a street that runs right through the middle of Chinatown. And
uh-huh.
in its heyday, there were 38 jazz clubs. That's where Ray Charles had his first paid gig. It's where Quincy Jones played. And it's where, you know, it's really, at the time, was populated with Chinese restaurants that, you know, they had gambling and booze from leftover from Prohibition times, but they also had the greatest jazz of the time on that one street. And it's this area where, you know, my grandfather would tell me that Cab Calloway would play, and I was always impressed
Duke,
by that.
And the Duke.
And the Duke.
And the Duke. Hotel on the corner of Bitter and Sweet, I think, actually tells two love stories. We'll talk about this possibility when we return.
You're listening to Conversations on the Coast with Jim Foster. Follow us on Twitter at JimFosterCOC or send an email to JimFosterCOC@gmail.com.
This is Jim Foster. It is Conversations on the Coast. We're talking about a wonderful debut novel called Hotel on the Corner of Bitter and Sweet. The author is Jamie Ford. And before we get into this notion of the second love story, I'd like you to read from your book
Sure.
a section that I think really gets across to us the hurt and the horror that takes place in Seattle and would take place anywhere if you decide to round up part of the population and throw them in jail. Could you do that?
I'd be happy to. Why are you taking pictures of garbage fires? Henry asked, not sure if the photographer even recognized him. The man looked through Henry. Then his eyes blinked as he seemed to remember him. It must have been the button Henry wore. The photographer turned back to his camera, his hands shaking. They're not burning garbage. Henry stood at the tee where the alley met the street, next to the photographer on his milk crate and his camera and his flash bulbs. Looking down the alley, he could see people coming and going from the apartment buildings, throwing things into the burning barrels. A woman yelled out of a third-story window to a man below and threw down a plum-colored kimono that looped and swirled, settling like falling snow on the dirty, slug-trailed pavement of the alley. The man below scooped it up, regarded it for a moment, hesitated, and then threw it on the fire. The silky fabric lit, and burning pieces floated out of the heat like butterflies whose wings caught flame, fluttering on the draft, flickering out and raining down as black, ashy dust. An old woman brushed by Henry with an armload of papers, throwing them into the fire, where they made a whooshing sound. Henry felt the rush of heat on his cheeks and stepped back. Even from a distance, he could see there were scrolls, artwork written and drawn by hand, large Japanese characters disappearing into the heart of the fire. Why are they doing this? Henry asked, not fully understanding what he was seeing. They arrested more people last night, Japanese all over the city, all over Puget Sound, all over the state maybe, the photographer told him. People are getting rid of anything that might connect them to the war with Japan. Letters, clothing, it all must go. Too dangerous to keep, even old photos. People are burning photos of their parents and of their families. Henry watched an old man wearily place a neatly folded Japanese flag into the nearest burning barrel, saluting it as it burned. The photographer snapped the shutter on his camera, capturing the scene.
Yeah, they're burning everything that connects them to the war, connects them to Japan, and also connects them to their own way of life, to right. their own culture.
Their own culture, their own history. Yeah.
Maybe this is a good time to share Garth Stein's comment. A tender and satisfying novel set in a time and place lost forever, Hotel on the Corner of Bitter and Sweet gives us a glimpse of the damage that is caused by war. Not the sweeping damage of the battlefield, but the cold, cruel damage to the heart and humanity of individual people. Especially relevant in today's world, this is a beautifully written book that will make you think, and more importantly, it will make you feel. And that's why I wanted you to read that passage.
Thank you.
Because that's really what you capture here, that aspect of war. Now, Ethel.
On to Ethel.
Ethel. Now, Ethel's never alive.
She's not.
She
sort of haunts the book.
She is dead of cancer.
Mm-hmm.
Henry has, by your account, done a fantastic job taking care of her. The only one who objects to the job he's done is his son,
mm-hmm.
who would rather have had her in a fancy place.
And the latest technology.
Yeah, and she dies essentially at home.
At home.
Under hospice care. How in the name of peace? I mean, there is another love story. He loves Ethel as much as, well, he shouldn't even talk like that. He loves Ethel and he loves Kiko.
He does. He sort of has his first love, but at the start of the story, we know that he's a widower. So we know that he's been married for decades to someone else and that he's done all the right things. He's done right by her in good times and bad through her cancer, through her illness, despite arguing with his own son of how her care should be managed. But she does sort of haunt him. You know, he sort of wallows in that lament over her and misses her. And she was always the bridge between father and son. And I think in a lot of relationships, we have that one person in the family that is the go-between, that the messenger.
And what's a kind of nice juxtaposition, if you will, is in his case, it's his son who helps him out of that, I can't do anything but think of Ethel, who's now gone.
Right. And he's, again, it's a confusion between father and son where he, you know, if you lose your spouse, how long do you need to wait? How long do you need to mourn? And I think he would mourn forever to not lose the respect of his son. And his son is the one encouraging him to
push on. Yeah. Wow. I'm right. There's two love stories in here.
There is.
I get an A+.
You got it. And it is. She just kind of haunts the book. I think a lot of us have that person in our life that was important, and perhaps they're gone, but their presence looms.
Oh, I don't know. This book has a long title, Hotel on the Corner of Bitter and Sweet. It's either one love story or two, and it also takes you back to a time this country cannot be proud of. But don't miss this book. This has been Conversations on the Coast, and I'm Jim Foster.
Follow us on Twitter at JimFosterCoc or send an email to JimFosterCoc@gmail.com.